All right. So using the correct activation initialization with the correct activation function can actually significantly lower the chances that you're going to have an unstable network with unstable weights. But sometimes that only stops the unstable gradient problem from happening in the beginning, and towards the middle parts of training or towards the end, you might actually get the unstable gradients problem again. So what we would do then is batch normalization. And I feel like batch normalization is kind of like the superhero that the whole deep learning community is very happy about. So let's talk about what that is. Basically, batch normalization is like normal normalization, is trying to make your data compress it to be in a certain range. So either you want to put it between 0 and 1, or you want to make the mean 0 and the standard deviation of the variance 1. For this one, for batch normalization, that's the one we're going for. What we're trying to do is we are trying to center the inputs on 0. So the mean or their average number is going to be 0. And we are trying to make the standard deviation 1. How we can do that is basically, normally, you know, you have to do it before you put your inputs, right? If your inputs range from, like, one of them goes from 0 to 100, the other one goes from 0 to 255, like we did in our hands-on example, if you remember. We are trying to normalize them and put them in between 0 and 1, so they all have the same scale. But for batch normalization, we don't only do it for the input layer. We do it for every layer that we have, or in between every layer, we put a batch normalization layer, and then we normalize the output that came from the previous layer, and only after we normalize this value, then we pass it on to the next layer. So let's talk about how this thing actually works. So again, normalization, it means that we're going to set the mean to 0 and standard deviation to 1. One little detail before I go into how it works is, as I said, if you want, you can also do the batch normalization before the input. So normally we do this by kind of manually. We either normalize values or standardize values before we give the input to the network. But if you don't want to deal with that, if you want to keep everything in one place, you can also have a batch normalization layer right before you give the inputs to your network. I'll show you more in the exercise, hands-on exercise anyways. But just so you know, you can also have a batch normalization layer here. Then you wouldn't have to normalize or standardize your inputs by yourself or manually. Okay, so for the scary part, this is how batch normalization works. But this is much, much, much simpler than how it looks. So let's start. What happens is, the first thing that we want to do, of course, is to find the mean, right? So let's say we have this group of numbers. These are our inputs with 3, 5, 8, 9, 11, 24. What I want to do is find their mean. Okay, very simple. Basically, what this means is what I wrote down here. I find their mean. I sum all of them and I divide them by the number of values that I have. One quick note here, though, is you might realize while training, you are giving your input to the network in batches most of the time. If you're doing stochastic gradient descent, you give them to the network one by one. If you're doing mini-batch gradient descent, you give it to the network in batches of whatever number you decided. So what's going to happen is, of course, this is the number of values in the batch. And again, then here, this mean is going to be calculated for the specific batch. So it might not completely represent the whole data set, right? So one solution they found to this and how it works on by default with Keras right now is that batch normalization uses a rolling average. So what it does is it calculates the mean for this first batch, it's 10. For the next batch, it calculates again if it's 12. Then it finds the average between those two. So basically, every time you give it a new batch, it is able to more correctly estimate the mean of the whole data set. So this is just something that you should keep in mind, but it's not going to affect how we do things on the code. The next step is to calculate the variance of this. And how do you calculate the variance? Again, very simple. Don't look at this really scary looking mathematics equation. You just get the number, and then you subtract the mean, and you take the square of all of those, sum them up, and then divide it by the number of values that you have. So here it looks like I forgot two brackets here, but of course this should be two brackets here. Let me fix that in one sec. All right, that's better. We don't want any incorrect calculations. The next one is calculating what the number should be now that we know the mean and the variance, right? So I'm only going to show you the calculation for the first one. If you want to, I mean, for three, basically the first element, if you want to try it out for all the other ones, please be my guest. I think it will be nice to see how it works. But basically, very simple equation. Again, we already calculated this guy. We already calculated this guy. We know what it is. This is the first value that we have. And epsilon is just a very, very, very small value that we add here so that we will not divide whatever is up here with zero. So in case the variance is zero, we don't want to do division by zero because that will break the computer. Or that would give us infinity, and we don't want infinity. We cannot work with infinity. So that's why, just in case if this number is ever zero, we add this very tiny number to avoid division by zero. And then it says, okay, now that I normalize this value, 3 actually needs to be minus 1.03. So if I do it for all of them, I'm going to get this list. So for 3, we have this number. For 5, we have this number. For 24, we have 2.06. And if you calculate their mean and standard deviation, you will see that their mean is 0 and their standard deviation is nearly 1, or variance is nearly 1. So if you know, variance is the square of standard deviation. So if one of them is 1, the other one needs to be 1 too, right? All right, last step. So we're not done here yet, unfortunately. So this has just been, I'll show you again, normalization, right? But we have this one last step here. And what it does is it rescales these values that we have and offsets them. And this is a part that the network actually learns. So these little guys, this one is something that we multiply the inputs with, these values, this normalized inputs. And offset is something that we add to them. So basically, when we add something, we kind of shift them either to the right or the left, or if you're subtracting something, and if you rescale them, you kind of increase them. But these are values that we learn in Bayes normalization to kind of transform the inputs or the outputs a little bit in hopes that our model will perform better, basically. This has all been training. So we have been training our network, and we found these values, and then, you know, we did it again and again and again, but this has been training. So what happens while we're testing? So these two values, rescale and offset value, are learned. Their best optimal values are learned during training. So they are basically parameters that need to be learned, right? We give one value to them, the model doesn't perform super well, we change their values and see when the model performs best. Whereas these two guys are things, as I said, we use a rolling average to calculate the average or the mean and standard deviation or variance of the inputs. But during test time, we will not be able to calculate the average, right? Or the standard deviation or the variance, because we will be giving the inputs to the network one by one. So what happens is you cannot just know the mean of, you cannot find the mean of one input. It is that value, but it's not going to be correct. It's not going to conform with what we have been calculating these two rescale and offset values with. So what is done to avoid this problem is basically these two values are also learned, but they're learned in a way of rolling average, basically. So we get the mean and variance for the first batch, we get the mean and variance for the second batch, and then we update, we combine those two to find an estimate for the whole mean and the mean for the whole data set and mean for the whole variance for the whole data set. And then the third batch comes in again, we use it for these calculations, but then we also calculate a rolling average for the general average and the general variance of the whole data set. So basically, those are all learned. Only these two are trainable. They are updated based on the training process, but these ones are just learned from the data set that we have. So this is basically how it works. Okay, now that we know this too, you might be wondering, okay, but like, why do we use batch normalization? So as we said, it is what it is. It's a way of centering the inputs around zero and then normalizing the inputs and then moving it around in a way that will help our network be the most effective or efficient or have the best performance. But why do we use this? Well, to avoid unstable gradients problem. But turns out, actually, batch normalization has some extra benefits on top of being a way of avoiding unstable gradients. First one is that we realized in time that it helps us achieve the same accuracy faster. So if you're not using batch normalization, you would have to train your network for a much longer time, for many more epochs, to get the same accuracy that you would get with batch learning, maybe with fewer epochs. And it can also sometimes lead to better performance. There are some research out there about this. Of course, this will, again, might depend on type of problem that you're solving. But I know, for example, for a network that has been worked on the ImageNet classification problem, it has shown better performance than the network that did not have batch normalization. And one other benefit is that when you are using batch normalization before you give the input to the network, then you don't even have to use the standardization layer. You don't have to do it manually, as we talked about. You can just use, so everything can be in one place. You will have batch normalization. One thing they found out is also that you do not need to use regularization anymore sometimes. So you can say it reduces the need for using regularization. Just a recall, regularization is something we do to avoid or lessen overfitting. So then we know that batch normalization also helps with overfitting. And lastly, kind of connected to the previous two points, then you train your network in less time. So specifically, each epoch, let's remember what epoch is, having one whole data set run through the whole network. Even if you're giving it in little batches, one epoch is us giving the network having already seen all of the data points. So those epochs, those things might last longer because of all the extra calculations that we're doing in between the layers. But in total, the number of minutes that the network would need to run to train on to converge or to learn the data, the patterns in the data, is going to be less when you're using batch normalization.